Amen. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. Stand with me as we prepare ourselves for our worship and what God is going to do in this place today. David, as he was king, everywhere he went, every time he worshiped God, every time he offered sacrifices, he gave to God his best, and it cost him something. He never took anything for free, even though he was king. When it came to God, he made sure that it came out of his sacrifice. So today, worship is going to cost you something. What are you willing to pay? I will not offer God anything that doesn't cost me anything. It's going to cost you something in this place. It's going to cost us effort. It's going to cost focus. It's going to cost us to set things aside and to lift him up and to see God do things in our lives. And if we do those things, he promises to inhabit the praises of his people. So that's a promise that we have if we will worship him. Father, we come to you in this place today. We've got a lot of things going on, a lot of things on our mind. We've come from a busy week, Lord. We're looking forward to a week that has a lot going on. But Father, in this place, in this moment, we set all of that aside, and we worship you. We lift you up. Father, we offer you our best. It may not be much, but Lord, we offer you our best, and we pray, Lord, that you would take that, and we would sense your presence in this place. Be glorified in everything that's said and done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Power of sin, darkness. that there is no name like yours, Jesus. The word says that all things on earth and under the earth shall, oh goodness, now I forget, shall worship his name, right? You know what verse I'm talking about. And so we worship a God who has a powerful name. The name of Yahweh, the name of Jesus, is not just a name to just David or Michael or Angelo. It is Jesus. And in his name, when we say the name of Jesus, when we just say his name and we don't know what to say, all we need to just say is Jesus. And so we're going to every chain, and we're going to say as we sing this, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power to break every chain. Not just ones that are things that are big things that we think about, right? Big sins. But there is no big sin. They're all sins at the feet of Jesus. And so, God, we just come to you today, Jesus. Lord, we just come to you today and lay them all down, God, that you would break every chain.
Redemption. chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. So break every chain, break every chain.
Break those chains now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. If you have physical pain here today, we just pray for you today. We pray that you would be healed in the name of Jesus. We pray that you would walk out of this place and that you would be set free from back pain is what I'm hearing, back pain. Lord Jesus, that you would come and heal back pain today, Jesus. Lord, that we may walk and not grow weary, Father, that we may run and not grow faint, Jesus. That we would rise up on wings like eagles, Father. Lord, that you would break every chain in this place, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you have back pain, I just ask that you would just raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord God, that you are healing this right now, Jesus. Lord, that you are working through us, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. sun. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. My soul, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. So I throw my hands. So I throw my hands. Praise you again and again. The song that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know it's not much. I'm nothing else fit for a king. Except for our heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's say it one more time. So I throw my hands, praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king. Except for a heart singing hallelujah.
Lord, hallelujah, Jesus, praise you, Lord, hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah, Lord Jesus, amen. We want to go to the Lord in prayer. We prayed for a couple of prayer requests last week. We prayed for Silas Smith. He was taken to the hospital. His appendix burst, and they took him in for surgery. He's doing fantastic. He's home and recovering, so all is well. And we pray for Kate Ford because she believed she had a seizure. And they did all kinds of tests and they could find nothing, absolutely nothing. So God is good, amen? Now, sometimes it's not good when they do an x-ray of your head and find nothing. But in this situation, it's a good thing. We're thankful for that and we celebrate with Kay and Brian. We continue to pray for Joan Guest. Joan is unable to be with us, still going through a lot of pain, going to doctors to try and figure out what that is. So we want to keep her in our prayers and keep my wife in your prayers. She's going in for a knee replacement surgery tomorrow. So keep her in prayer. And keep me in prayer, because she's a very good patient. So, but anyway, let's pray that God brings speed. There's so much on her plate, and let's just pray that God just do something special there. So if before you leave today, you let her know you're praying for her, it would be greatly appreciated. We want to pray for Israel in the Middle East, that God would just intervene. The Bible tells us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. People of Israel are God's people, and they play a special role in the end time. So we want to keep that whole situation in our prayers. We want to continue to pray for Tom Scott. He's continuing to look for a job. Been to several interviews, but nothing has worked out. So let's pray for Tom. And also pray for his family, him and his family. They'll be traveling next weekend to go on a mini vacation, much needed. And pray that God bless them in a special way. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you that we're reminded of your faithfulness and answers to prayer. Lord, we thank you for what you've done in Silas and in Kay. And Lord, we pray that you continue to work in their lives and work in a special way. We pray for Joan, Lord. We continue to lift her up. Lord, you know what it is. We need you to give the doctors wisdom and guidance. And Father, for Miss Patty, we pray that you would touch her, bring a healing to her body. Lord, Dr. Stillwell is not going to be doing the operating tomorrow. You will, the great physician, Lord. So I pray you take over, and that, Lord, all will work for your glory and honor in a special way. We pray for the situation in the Middle East. And Lord, we pray that you would work a miracle, Father, that you would intervene. We know, Father, that the heart of the kings are in your hands. And Lord, that nothing is impossible for you. So, but we also know, Lord, that you've got a plan and a purpose. So we pray that you would work in that situation and through the parties involved and work a miracle. Protect Israel, Lord, and be with them in a special way. Father, we pray for Tom Scott, Lord, that you would, Lord, he needs that right job. So, Lord, work a perfect miracle in him, Lord. Open that door and answer prayer and be with his family. And Lord, bless them with a special time together next weekend. They would know you in a very special way. So, Lord, we pray that you be honored by everything that's said and done in this place. And, Lord, may it bring glory and honor to your name, we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said together, amen. Amen. Before you're seated, smile at somebody, shake their hand, let them know you're happy to see them in the house of the Lord, and welcome them. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I do want to thank you for your faithfulness to the Lord and to Ithaca First. It's through your faithful giving that we are able to do what we do in ministry. I've learned something through my life, and that's this. If I can't trust God with something, I'll never be able to trust him for it. If I can't trust God with something, I'll never be able to trust him for it. If there's something in my life I keep away from God because I want it and I'm not interested in him being a part of it, whether it's money, whether it's relationships, then when I'm in need, I will not be able to trust him for something that I can't trust him with. I've learned that God knows how to take care of what is his. Amen? Amen? God knows how to take care of what is his. And when I give God my finances, I say, God, this is yours. It's your problem, not mine. If I can trust him with it, then I can trust him for it when something goes wrong. Amen. And so it's a sign of faith and it's a sign of worship as we honor the Lord with our tithe and offerings. I do want to make mention that if you are new or you've never been to a pastor's brunch, and I did meet someone today that I never met before, go online and fill out a connection card. Let us know so that we can invite you to a brunch and you get a chance. We get a chance to meet each other and talk about the church. And you can go to the guest services after service. There's a kiosk there and you can fill it out or even do it on your phone, IthacaFirst.org. And we will get in connection and contact with you. Our life groups start in 2 weeks, and we'll have more information about that as the service goes on. So even those online, make sure you are looking on our webpage to see what we have to offer in the upcoming weeks. Turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, verses 42 and 43. Stand with me with respect to the word. I want to introduce you to the second life group that was ever held in the history of the church. All right? Peter stood up after Pentecost and 3,000 were saved. What do you do with what do you do with 3,000? Let's try and figure this out. And it says that all the believers devoted themselves to the teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. Because of that, a deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miracles, signs, and wonders. Father, we give this time to you. You know what we have need of. So I pray, Lord, that as we open our hearts to you, that you will speak to us. And if you speak to us, we make this commitment in this place, we will hear and obey. Work beyond the failures and shortcomings of this pastor to do what only you can do by your Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I said I want to introduce, this is the second life group ever held in history of the church. The first one was held, and the facilitator of that life group was Jesus. And he picked 12 people to be a part of that life group. They walked together, they ate together, they talked together, he taught them, and they shared together. And in this passage, we understand now after 3,000 are added to the church, the question is, what do you do with 3,000? How are you going to handle this? And the answer to that is to do the same thing with the 3,000 that Jesus did with the 12. And so they went about doing these things that are spoken of here. As a group and in groups, amen. Building relationship. How do you overcome difficult circumstances? How do you make it in a society and an environment that hates you? That's what they were facing. How do you grow in your faith? How do you live out your faith? How do you keep relationships? How do you conquer life while you're trying to do all those things? Oh, I got an idea. Let's devote ourselves. Let's be committed. So they devoted themselves. The word devoted there is a favorite word of Luke's. It means a binding promise or a pledge for a season of time, for a moment. I'm going to make a commitment and a pledge before God and you that for these 8 weeks or 10 weeks, I'm going to be committed to you and to God to do the following things. Amen. And they made those commitments. Interestingly, it says they devoted themselves. Because the only one you can devote is, you see, I can't stand up here and say, I devote Shane to 4 life groups this semester.
Amen.
You see his eyes? You can't devote what's not yours. The only thing you can devote and commit, they devoted themselves. It is a personal commitment that you are making for a season of time. Now, was it an easy commitment? Was it something that they did because they had more time than anyone else? You know, I often think of that. They say that modern conveniences are supposed to make our life easier, right? So we have a phone that's a camera and encyclopedia and a movie projector and it's everything, right? It would take, you know, 30 years ago, you would have to fill this room with all kinds of equipment for the things that you have on your phone. I heard one person say, there's more technology in your phone than there was in all of the technology that put a man to walk on the moon. And you hold it in the palm of your hand. Okay, but does that make our life easier? No. We're supposed to be filled with all this leisure time. Think about it then. When the disciples, or when they had to go somewhere, they didn't jump in a car, they didn't make a phone call, they didn't tweet somebody. You know, you had to take out, a quill and ink and roll out paper, and then you had to walk it. When it says Jesus walked to Capernaum, that was a big deal. No, they didn't need Fitbits. They got their steps in.
Amen.
So the point I'm making here is this. They had lives. They were husbands, they were wives, they were moms, they were dads, they were business owners, they were workers. Each of them still had normal everyday lives and priorities. But they came to a place that said, in this point in time, I am, even though I'm busy and I have all of these things, I am going to commit myself. I'm going to prioritize this thing in my life. Jesus changes everything. When we walk with him, he wreaks havoc on our priorities. Have you ever noticed that? And they were learning that. They committed themselves to what? The Bible says they committed themselves to teaching. All the believers devoted themselves to teaching. That's what God gave us this book for.
Amen.
It's the instruction manual. I know that most of us don't like instruction manuals. Most of us, especially men, I don't need that. I can figure it out. Have you ever done that? And then there's that one warning that says, if you put this part on backwards, you will never be able to get it off and put it back on. I'm not saying that ever happened to me. God gave us this book so that we could grow. God gave us each other so that we could grow. We learn and grow from each other. Romans chapter 6, but thanks be to God, though you used to be slaves, you came to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching. That's an interesting passage. The pattern of teaching that is now claimed by you. In order for us to grow in our faith, we have to take this and we have to learn it in patterns.
Amen.
If you come to service every day for the rest of your life,
Amen.
You will not know the Bible.
Amen.
If you came to Sunday service every week for the rest of your life, because in a half hour, I'm preaching on different things, but there's no pattern. You have to be able to take an opportunity to take this scripture and look at it systematically, understanding what God has to say about specific topics or passages of scripture or books of the Bible. And learn it in a pattern and understand, oh, that's what he means. That's what the Bible says. That's how we understand it. That's what God's trying to tell us. There are 1,189 chapters in the Bible. 31,103 verses. If you studied one verse a day, chronologically, one verse a day, it would take you 86 years. To finish the Bible. Now, statistics tell us that less than 10% of Christians read the Bible more than once a week. So if we're going to grow in the teaching, we need to sit down and say, God, what are you doing? And study with others in a pattern what he is saying about different things in the scripture. They committed to teaching. The second thing they committed to is fellowship. All of the believers devoted themselves to relationship with each other. They devoted themselves to each other. Amen. Understand that the early church knew that we are better together. They knew that following Jesus was a team sport. There is an article I read many years ago that freaked me out. There was this neighborhood and in Maine, or Massachusetts. And there was this lady, she was 73 years old, that lived in this neighborhood, and she didn't keep her house very well. She was all by herself. And her name was Adele. And the neighbors noticed things about her house. They noticed that the grass, she didn't do anything with the grass and let it grow. The town wouldn't do anything. The police wouldn't do anything. So one day they hired a person and they came in and bushwhacked the grass. They just got tired of seeing it. They're like, if she ain't going to do anything, I don't want it to take my property levels down. And I bushwhacked it. They noticed that her mail in her mailbox was overflowing. They're like, oh, this is, you know, an eyesore. So the neighbors took turns taking her mail and throwing it in the garbage. They noticed things. They complained about things. They talked about her. But finally, the police came to the house and knocked on the door. No one answered. They broke in and found the skeletal remains of Adele that they assumed had been already been dead for between 3 to 4 years. They asked the neighbor, and listen to what this person said. I guess it's not really a friendly neighborhood. No fooling. I once was a close friend of Adele, but I haven't seen her in years, and I guess now I know why. Her house was 20 feet from Adele's. And she said, I'm as much to blame as anyone. This story is unbelievable, how someone could be that disconnected. But understand, noticing about, complaining about, talking about is not caring about. Amen. It's not connecting. If we are going to be in a relationship that grows with each other, we have got to connect with each other, and we've got to be in relationship. So the question is, are you trying to become all that God's called you to be on your own, it will never work, because the Bible says it is not good for us to be alone. You have to be in relationship. If you think you can grow and be the best Christian you can be, never coming to church, never having a relationship with anyone, and just watching it on TV, not going to happen. Following Jesus is a we thing. That's why we encourage you to join Life Group. Because there are going to be people in there that you think highly of. There are going to be people there that you're going to be like, but God's going to use that life group because you can't hide from each other. There's going to be people in that life group that iron sharpens iron. And then there are going to be people in that life group that are soothing to the soul. You have people in your life that are just, every time you get a text from them or something, you're like, oh, you could just feel that healing balm. Growing in relationship with one another. Cain asked God, am I my brother's keeper? And the answer was one word, yes, you are. You are your brother's keeper. You're responsible for each other. It's not enough for you to notice, oh, you know the person that sits here is not here. They haven't been here in months, but I guess they probably watch it online. So I'm not going to worry about it. A new command I give unto you, that one another as I have loved you. They committed themselves to teaching and to relationship. And the third thing is to meals. Something happens when we eat together. Now that's, we churches got that down pretty good. We eat pretty good. Matter of fact, I see Lily here. And a few weeks ago, my wife had an appointment after church. She took the car and I was here, and after church was over, I knew I was going to be here by myself for 2 hours. And my stomach reminded me that I don't eat before I preach for very good reason. All of a sudden, sitting on that plate table there, right next to where my chair was a Tupperware, and it said, Pastor, enjoy. It was Spanish rice. From Lily. Ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't eaten it here, her rice, you will be eating it at the marriage supper of the Lamb, I promise you. That's what we're going to be served in heaven. But I'll tell you, something happens when you're eating, right? David said, Thou preparest the table for me in the presence of my enemies. You know what I think of then? I think of God on the other side of that table and me on this side. And we're sharing communion and food. And the world is almost going to hell in a handbasket. All of the enemies around you, but in this place, there is peace. In this place, God is ministering. Amen. So when we take an opportunity to be hospitable with each other, great things can happen as we are sharing together and opening ourselves. So invite someone to coffee or come have coffee. Every life group eats well here. We make sure of that. I think the first week, where's my kitchen crew, Patty, where is she? Oh, she's back there. I think for the first week we got lobster and filet. I may be wrong, right? I'll have to check that out. But there's something happens when you take an opportunity to eat. And the final thing they're committed to is prayers. And all the believers devoted themselves to praying. Galatians chapter 6, carry each other's burdens. If we're going to follow Christ, we must be committed to praying for one another. It's not enough to know something. You must pray. When we take the prayer requests and we pray, we say pray for them. I want to encourage you. There's a responsibility that comes when you know of a prayer request. When somebody has the courage to be vulnerable and say, this is a need in my life. I'm going to share it with a couple hundred people and then maybe another 100 online that I have no idea who they are. During the week, pray for these requests. Because something can happen where two or three agree together. Be committed to praying for one another. James chapter 5 says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other that you may be healed. So, the Bible tells us that they committed to teaching and to fellowship and relationship and to eating and to praying. And then what happened? It says that God moved and everyone was filled with awe. When we grow together and we commit to ourselves, we devote ourselves to these things, God grows in our lives and we see Him do amazing things. Does God still awe you? Are you in awe of Him? Do you remember when you just got married? Amen. And you wake up before your spouse does and you're looking at them like, and they wake up like, ah! I'm like, oh, I was just watching you sleep. It's so beautiful. Amen. Everything was awe. 40 years later, you're like, Don't let God become that in your life. I want to be awed by Him. How about you? I want to see God answer and move and do something where I can say, man, God, you are so awesome. You are so awesome. We think that's an emotional thing. We think that happens when we touchy-feely, or we think something special has to play, or EJ has to work his magic on the keyboard in worship. And if the right song in the right place with the right person happens, no. When we commit ourselves to do the work, to learn systematically, to be in relationship, to share together, and to pray together, we will be what God can do in our lives. Amen? We're going to take an opportunity to introduce you to our facilitators, and then you will have the awesome opportunity to register before you leave today, if you're listening or watching, I want to encourage you, all of these, the life groups are available online and they'll be registering online, but you can as well. So IthacaFirst.org, and you will have an opportunity to join us. On Monday evenings at 6:30, Pastor Lonnie is going to be teaching on the book 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. If you're facilitating one of our life groups, why don't you come and sit in the front row here, and then when your turn comes, we'll have an opportunity for you to share together. She's going to be teaching on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and that'll be in the living room, which is off the fellowship hall. Pastor Lonnie, why don't you come and tell us what that's all about?
A shocking experience there. Sorry about that. Okay, so I have to start last year, actually, to 2023. There's a group of us that was reading through the Bible chronologically and taking time to talk about it as we went. And it got to be about November-ish, and I was really excited to get into the book of Revelation. So my thought, and I'm just kind of suspicious that there's been a few of us like this, if I could just get through 1st, 2nd, 3rd John and Jude, I can get into Revelation. All right, so I thought, okay, I'm going to do this in one day. I'm going to do this. All right? And I know some of you did it because some of you confessed it already. All right? So, as I started in reading 1 John, I got to verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no fellowship. Oh, I'm sorry. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet we walk in darkness, we lie. And we do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
Amen.
Amen.
And one that we all know by heart, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just.
Amen.
And will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. And I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but all of a sudden the Spirit of God came down, poof, and hit my Bible, and it is underlined in yellow. However, it looked like neon lights flashing, like, And for the first time, I mean, I've read through the Bible year after year, but for the very first time, God stopped me right there. And I knew it was the Holy Spirit of God saying to me, can you imagine, just imagine, what it would be like if the church of God, the whole body of Christ, lived according to this.
Amen.
And the next thing that happened was it changed. The message changed. And he said, can you imagine? And I felt the Spirit deep within me say, imagine what it would be like if you lived like this.
Mm.
And the next thing I knew, I was just down. I went from my recliner to the floor on my hands and knees.
Amen.
And for the first time, I realized in my hurry to get through 1st, 2nd, 3rd, John, Jude, to get to Revelation, that the Church of God is missing a lot of this.
Amen. Amen.
And I knew back then, it was early November, that I'm considering this for life group. And it's been confirmed to me over and over again. Just think about it. What would it be like if we were to live like this? And so that's what I did choose for my life group. And wouldn't you know, today, if you follow the version on the Bible, and the verse for today happens to be 1 John 4, about verse. I said it's just overconfirmated, all right? So this is the thing here. My heart is to make the Word of God come alive.
Amen.
And to make it relevant for today, but to make it more than just words on a paper. I love making the Word of God come alive. And so I would invite you to join us. We're doing 1st, 2nd, 3rd John on Monday nights. I know Jude is usually included in this, and I'm going to have to stick some of it in there because you can't miss Jude in the process of getting to Revelation, because we're all looking forward to Ed in Revelation, but this is like a bridge. So you're getting the bridge to Revelation at the same time you're getting Revelation.
Amen.
So I encourage you to come and join us. I think the Lord, if he enlightened my eyes with neon lights in my Bible, then I'm trusting him to do amazing things Monday evening.
Amen.
Okay, I really am. That's the first one. The second one I wanted to just briefly tell.
Mm-hmm.
Last Last semester in the fall, we started a group called Good Grief. And we started it because there's been a lot of people who have lost different things during the couple of years, you know, and a lot of grieving has been going on. People have lost, you know, loved ones, they've lost relationships, they've lost income, they've lost identity, they've lost a lot of identity of themselves.
That's right, that's right.
The last several years. And so I really felt that it was time for me to step up. I've had to go through my own time of grieving when my husband passed, and it was just kind of, can I do something like this? And the Lord said, yeah, it's time. It's time to start doing something
Amen.
Like this. So after the semester was over, we transitioned into more of a support group that we still continue to meet on the third Friday of the month, every month at 10 o'clock in the living room. But I just wanted to open it up again to everybody. This is for everybody, no matter what you've lost, whether it's been a death in the family or some loss of relationship or something, you know you're grieving and you need help with the process, or you just want to be surrounded with people who have gone through similar things, and it's just an encouragement. I welcome you to join us, and I leave it out there. I'm open to talking to anybody if you have a need, and let's talk about it, okay? I found that this is just more than a life group. This is going to be something probably ongoing as needed, and just to leave that open for anybody, okay? So get in touch with me, and I'm your pastor, and he can get in touch with me, and we can work together.
Amen. Amen. I also encourage you, if you know somebody that's grieving and you need tools to help them with that, this would be helpful as well. Our next life group is the Book of Revelation. That's going to be on Wednesday evenings at 6:30 right here in the sanctuary. And we had Revelation taught 4 years ago, but it's getting more and more relevant even now as we speak. So Ed is the facilitator. He's going to come and share with you about the group.
Yes, good morning. My life group is going to be on a verse-by-verse study of the Book of Revelation, which is a prophetic book. It's the last book in the Bible, and it describes basically what's going to happen during the end times. And I have a scripture verse here. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3 says, "Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near."
Amen.
So it says, blessed is he who reads. Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises us a blessing for studying it. But the blessing's not in just reading the book. The blessing is to those who hear it and take it to heart.
Amen.
Okay? Just reading it doesn't qualify to receive the blessing. We must give heed to it. So the expectation is to not only to read the book, but also to take it in, to obey it, and take it into your heart. And then when we read and study and obey this book, then we get a revelation of who Jesus is. Okay, that he's the King of Kings, he's the Lord of Lords, and that he's coming back again, and that we're going to rule and reign with him.
Amen.
That's what the Bible teaches us. Okay? And after we study this book, we can then apply that revelation to our lives. All right? But before we get into the verse-by-verse study, we're going to briefly look at the question, or the answer that Jesus gave in Matthew chapter 24 when he was asked, what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? So we're going to start with that before we even dig into the book. We're also going to read several chapters in the book of Daniel and Ezekiel, because those books in the Old Testament hold the key to understanding.
Amen.
The book of Revelation.
Amen.
All right. So we're going to do a deep dive into this, the book of Revelation, and bring your Bibles to class if you do sign up.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
There's one qualification. When Ed came to me and said he wanted to teach on book of Revelation, Ithaca First Assembly, Pastor John only has one requirement for anyone that wants to teach the book of Revelation, and they must believe that the angel... Come on.
There's a couple of versions.
The one I'm on.
The verses where they talk about the angel in the book of Revelation is actually talking about the pastors of the church. So, and during that that session, I'll be sure that Pastor John is here so we can listen to it and we can build him up.
Because I need all the help I can get. That's Thank right. you. Thank you very much, Ed. All right. We have another life group going on Wednesday evening. It's co-ed as well. All of these are co-ed. Going to be in room 105, teaching the book of Acts on life in the Spirit. George Welsh, come and tell
us. All right, I'm going to read what I wrote because I'm too long-winded. Last Wednesday in Bible study, one of the guys said something that really astonished me. He was witnessing to a man about the Lord, and the man, if I understood him correctly, gave him this analogy of how short life is. And because of this, he wasn't going to waste it on what God wanted him to do, but do just what he wanted. He drew a pencil point on the wall, and then he took the pencil and, pretending to draw a line around the large room, came back to the pencil point. Pointing to it, he said, "This point is my life on this earth, and eternity is the line around the room." The insight that he showed in the reality of our situation was God-given. His conclusion is what astounded me. Okay. Psalms 39 says this: "You have made my days a mere hand's breadth, the span of my years as nothing before you. Everyone is a breath, even those who seem secure."
Amen.
Whether you're 17, not having a platform here. Whether you're 17 or 69, life is but a breath. With the reality of this in mind, how should we live? We should live our lives in the light of God's eternity, making the most of the short time God has given us in this world. How long is God's eternity? This man had insight, but didn't grasp how long eternity is. There's no beginning and no end. It's eternity. I think of the hymn, "When we've been there 10,000 years.
Amen.
10,000 years.
Amen.
We've no less days to sing
Amen.
His praise."
Amen.
So, in the next 8 weeks, men and women who laid down their lives, sold everything they had for God, and who invited the God who invited them to share in his eternity, they used the power and ability God gave them to face a hostile society with God's truth and love. It changed the world.
Amen.
We will continue studying how to use those God-given abilities and apply them to our lives in the society that we face today, that we may live up to the calling that God has given us, facing the challenges God presents to us with his power and his ability. The first part of the session, we will be finishing up the book of Acts and then flowing into a study of the fruit of the Spirit. What the Bible says about obtaining and using his fruit, learning together how to walk in all that God has for us. If you're a man or woman of God that is interested in learning more about what God says about this, then please join us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Our youth are meeting in room 107. EJ's done an awesome job getting that looking super awesome. He's going to be teaching for the 8 weeks on his life group. EJ, come and share.
So for the eight weeks, we're going to do a series called Fierce. This is going to encourage the students to follow Jesus with boldness and confidence. I just want to go over what the topic is for the 8 weeks that we have. So for week one, it says fierce faith. We'll be in Proverbs, Hebrews, Romans, and James, just going around with those. It says, when you know who you are in Christ, you become bold and fearless, and fearless in faith. For week two, we'll do fierce prayers. And then it says, because of God's grace, you can come before him without shame and offer bold prayers. Week three, fierce boldness. It says, God removes your fear and doubts and replaces it with his love and boldness. Week four is fierce friendships. Love your friends with the same fierce love that God has for you. Week five, fierce perseverance. You can fiercely pursue God, knowing that he will always be with you through the highs and lows of your life.
Amen.
Week six, fierce integrity. We must honor God with fierce integrity, both in front of others and when no one's looking.
Amen.
We've got fierce love. God's love towards us compels us to boldly show love to each other.
Amen.
And the last, in week eight, we have fierce living. As you boldly live like Jesus, others will follow your example.
Amen.
So yeah, if you have any students from grades 6 to 12, please bring them. Bring them. We normally feed the kids also before. Yeah, that's always not a good thing.
Amen.
Yeah, so just bring them out. We'll have a good time. Yes.
Amen. Thank you. And they do a good job feeding them, that's for sure. I always raid their food because Megan's an awesome cook. You see all this artwork and what's on here and on the webpage is a result of Megan Jefferson's hard work. Let's let her know we appreciate it. Our next, we got our children's life group, and they're going to be studying the topic, I Survived. Janelle Bowman.
All kids will survive. So I'm going to do a series about, I Survived. And we're going to ask the question, can you survive? So each week we'll do different stories from the Bible about anything from the flood to the plagues and Daniel, the lion's den, and the fiery furnace. So we'll talk about the story and what the Bible tells us, and then the kids will get the opportunity to try and survive these things. So I'm not going to light anybody else on fire, but I will light myself on fire or my hand on fire. So they get to experience that. And at the end, if that's not inspiring enough for you to bring your kids, next week I'm going to be in with the kids so they get to hear this again so they can pester their parents. But in the end, even if they didn't enjoy the rest of the time, they get to throw paintballs at me if they can answer questions about what they loved. So why not take your shot?
Yeah. Thank you. And permission release forms and medical forms will be sent home with the parents on the first week. All right. Anything that happens in church, we are not responsible for. But anyway, she's one of the most creative people with children I've ever met, and she does a beautiful job. But thank God for her. Our nurseries will be housed for 2 to 4 years of age. We have nursery care. Bobby and Andrea will be taking care of that. They're both here. Stand up. Let's let them know we appreciate them. Our next life group is on Thursday morning at 10 o'clock, facilitated by Miss Sarah Perry. Sarah.
Well, we're doing The Chosen, and it's really about family. And as you can tell, I'm all about family,
mm-hmm.
whether I want to be or not. No, I'm just So we did do The Chosen One, which if you guys don't know about it, is a series about the life and ministry of Christ. And the important thing about it is to bring Christ to life more than just, you know, feeding your spirit. It makes Jesus real. And it's made us family. And I'm welcoming you to join our family because, you know, we've all got problems that we slog through. But when we have each other, our problems become an opportunity to grow together. They become an opportunity to get to know each other, to help each other, and to actually find, like, beauty in our struggles. And so, like Pastor said, there's food, too, and it's good. And we just love each other. And so we're growing. We add, we subtract, we add back. But it's a beautiful thing. And then we get to, like I said, watch. We alternate weeks between watching The Chosen episode and having prayer and then discussing it the following week and having, you know, prayer and fellowship. And it's not 8 weeks, so there is that. But we just keep going. And we may mix in some service projects in there as needed, you know, with people. But we're basically just doing life together. And so Thursday mornings at 10, if you can make it. People have gotten creative. Some people actually still work at that time, and they take their lunch break to come out. So you never know. Anything's possible. So I hope to see you then.
Thank you. Our next life group is quilting, and Miss Nora is facilitating that. And while you're at it, talk about our service project, too.
God bless you. The quilting ministry, I was listening to a preacher driving in my car one time talking about the parable of the lost sheep from Matthew, and it just struck me that everyone is so valuable to the Lord. Everyone. And so I just, in my mind, I'm thinking one lost sheep, and the Lord didn't give us the ministry till I met someone else here at the church and we started the quilting ministry. It is God's will for everyone to be saved. And we all go through really hard things in our lives. So the renovation house and Potter's Hand, which is a ministry that takes care of women who have been subject to human trafficking, and renovation house for men and women, taking care of people, ministering to them through their struggles and addictions. And so what quilting ministry is able to do is take all the little bits and pieces that other people have discarded or thrown away and put them together into something beautiful for them to know that they're loved and cared about, thought of, prayed for, and they can have the comfort of having a quilt that's one of a kind, just like them. Christ died for all of us, and we don't get to see the all of us. And we have to remember that the us is us. We are those, and so we are those in need. So we're doing that. We'll be meeting, and everyone is welcome, even if you don't sew. We've got people that come that just help participate in fellowship. They cut things. They match things, they do things, and even our youth are welcome to come. We meet from 4:30 to 7, come as you will, and come as you are. The other thing is the outreach ministry that we're doing right now is called Love Packages. Megan did a great job putting this together for us, and this is an opportunity for us to take the overflow of scripture materials that we have in our homes and reach out to your friends, let them know we're collecting Bibles, we're collecting devotionals, we're collecting other resource materials for pastors, teachers, evangelists, missionaries, and lay people in 30 plus countries and across the United States for people who do not have the Word of God in a written form. We'll take all languages, we'll take any condition. We're going to be doing it the whole month of April. We are hoping to set up a drive-through Saturday, so if you don't want to bring it to church on Sunday, and for those of you who are watching, if you don't come on Sundays, we'd love to still have your overflow that can really bless and minister the Word of God to people who maybe have not heard or maybe need to grow in their faith. Teachers who are learning how to be teachers, evangelists, and missionaries. So God bless you. If you have any questions, let me know. I'm working with a fantastic team, and we will be here for you, with you, in Jesus' name.
And our last life group is meeting on Thursday evenings, and Fadia is facilitating. She's going to come and tell us about it.
Our life group is called Teach Us to Pray, and we started last year, and we are still doing Teach Us to Pray because this is something that takes all our lives to learn how to pray. So this time we are going to look at the Hebrew names of God. It looks big, but it's very easy because this is the identity of God. This is the character of God. And that's how he showed himself to the Israelites. He told Moses about a couple of his names. We're going to look in the Bible about some verses and some stories. And also, you remember that verse in Psalm 9, which says, those who know your name will put their trust in you. So what is his name? We need to learn together, what is his name in the Bible? Is he Elohim, the creator? Is he Jehovah, as he showed himself to Moses? When he came, Moses knew God before. He knew Elohim, but he didn't know Jehovah. He didn't know the one that is having relationship with him. So he asked him, who are you? What can I tell them? We are going to look at these verses in the Bible. We are going to look at El Shaddai. We are going to look at Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi. If you have any problem, he is your victory. So we are going to learn the depth of these names, and we are going to learn how to pray them. Because if we know who he is, we will know how to direct what we need to that name. And that's what he wanted to reveal to us. We are going to study it together. We are going to pray together. And we are going to glorify his name together. And this will be Thursday at 6 o'clock. And bring friends, please.
Amen. So it's going to be an exciting semester. I encourage you. Stand with me. We'll close in prayer. You can go out in the lobby. Our facilitators are leaving now. They'll be out there waiting for you. And grab yourself a piece of candy and talk to them about the class. If you're watching, you can do it online, IthacaFirst.org. Or even here, you could go on your phone and do it. Sign up for any one of those. When you do, the facilitator will be contacting you, giving you details about the first meeting. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your presence in this place. We pray that you would be with us, Lord. We're excited to take this journey. We are committed to each other and to you. And we pray that you would work miracles through these groups in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, and stop in the lobby.